All right, it's time to get started. Hello and welcome to Accidental Origin Episode 1. Hi, my name is Brendan, and I'm a writer. If you couldn't tell by my overly ridiculous use of hashtags, and this is the first episode of my show. So, hi, hello, how goes it? Just working through the nerves, as it were. So this is Accidental Origin. A little bit about myself. I'm 24 years old, Irish Canadian. I started writing when I was 12 years old. Audio problems? Alright, let me... let me just double check my audio here. Oh, I hear myself. I hear myself. Oh. Oh, my bad. Okay, cool, yeah. Getting used to it. Total interruption. Ridiculous. I'm like 5 minutes into the stream. Okay, so a little bit about myself. I'm 24. I'm Irish Canadian. I started writing when I was 12 years old. After seeing one of my cousins when she came to visit, when she came to visit, she showed me a novel she was working on, and it was the first time I'd kind of been confronted with the idea that that's something someone could do, just anybody could do. Not that she's just anyone or anything, but that I could do it. And up to that point, I'd been pretty voracious reader. I read a ton, and I was reading well past my age up to that point and all that stuff, and it was the first kind of moment where I was like, hey, that's something I could do. And so the first thing I ever wrote, and this is always embarrassing to admit, but first thing I ever wrote was fan fiction. I had a story that was approximately 5-10,000 words. Published it a couple times over a spit, or probably about 5 chapters over a span of about 4 or 5 months. And I can't remember for the life of me what I called it or where I posted it. But I definitely remember the idea, and I'm still kind of developing it as a comic book, as an original comic book, not as a fan fiction. Kind of like changed a lot of stuff and rebuilt it from the ground up in a lot of ways. So that's where I got my start. I took a lot of English courses in high school, including English Lit, just general English, and creative writing. So I did a lot of that. I applied to get into a writing art school at one point, and I did get in, but I couldn't go because it was way too far from my house. So there was no way of me really getting there properly. Like, I'd miss a lot of class and stuff if I missed the bus, and I probably was going to miss the bus. And there was a ton of poetry, which... maybe in hindsight, probably would have been super beneficial, but I wasn't super into it at the time. Right now, I'm pretty awful at poetry, and I probably always will be. It's not really my strength. So there's totally that. And then in university, I wrote for the school paper, York's Excalibur, which is a really awesome newspaper. I did a lot of stuff with them. I was staff writer for 2 years. And then I went on to college, and I studied screenwriting at college for a year. Fortunately, my life took a lot of twists and turns, so I didn't graduate. But that's okay. That's okay. It was, there's a lot of decisions there, and I don't regret any of those decisions. I'm much, much happier and much healthier not being in school. But, you know, those are the breaks, right? So, yeah. And that had nothing to do with writing or my enjoyment or any of that stuff. So I continue to do that to this day. And right now I work full time retail, and I write pretty much every day. I try to write every day, and it's going pretty well for me right now. So, yeah, that's who I am. That's who I am. I love visual storytelling. I study screenwriting, obviously. I love comic books. I love manga. I am really interested in that kind of storytelling and that kind of writing. So we will probably be doing some of that. Not to start, but eventually we will get into some of that stuff. And I'm hoping it's gonna be awesome. I think it'll be awesome. So we'll see how it goes. Yeah. So the first question that I'm probably gonna get asked here by anyone who isn't one of my friends is that, you know, what is an accidental origin? What does that mean? Why is that important? You know, what is it all about? So, to start, it's actually a play on the trope of a freak lab accident, which is a superhero trope. And it's kind of the idea of some catastrophe happening and it causing some sort of origin story. So, you know, the big examples for me are Spider-Man. You know, he attends this event and this spider drops down and bites him, and what's given him his powers. Totally on accident. Like, he had nothing to do with it. It wasn't deliberate on his part. It wasn't deliberate on anyone's part. Though, when you read some of the other retellings of the story, they do imply some other things about that. But yeah, like, that sort of accidental origin, you know. It's that change in the status quo that takes someone from an idle passerby to becoming the hero of a story, to go down the path of the hero's journey. And that's an important idea in storytelling, the idea of the hero's journey and that sort of inciting incident that causes the status quo to change and forces them to do something, to want something or do something or need something that really pushes them to be something that they're not at the current moment. As heavily influenced by comics as I am and how interested I am in visual storytelling, that's going to come up a lot, the idea of comics and comic sort of influence, though it does apply to a lot of other things. Talk about, here's a great example. Odysseus, when he's on the Odyssey. No, he's coming back from the sacking of Troy. And he gets lost. He gets lost, and suddenly everything is different. His story is different, and that difference is what makes that story interesting, right? We knew Odysseus was this awesome guy, and he was very smart, and he came up with the idea for the Trojan horse and all this cool stuff, but that sort of getting lost and forcing him through all those trials and tribulations so he can get back home, like, that's what makes him real, like a real important literary figure for us. And yeah, he, you know, total accidental origin, right? He didn't deliberately get lost. It just happened. And it caused those changes. So I hope that was a pretty clear explanation, but if anyone does want me to reiterate, I certainly can. So the second question that I think people are going to ask is, why start a web show? Yeah, you're a writer, and yeah, you do all this stuff, but why a web show? Why broadcast on Twitch? Why are you doing this? So for me, I've actually been spending a lot of time in Twitch Creative lately. I watch a lot of artists. I mean, art is one of the primary things that people do on Twitch Creative. I know there are quite a few musicians now and a few other things, but mostly what you see are artists, especially digital artists, though not all, by any means. So yeah, I've been watching a lot of artists, and I listen to them how they talk about art and how they talk about why they stream and how they talk to their viewers who ask questions and all that stuff. And it really got me thinking, you know, like, I'm writing a lot. I have tons of thoughts about the writing process that I've spent time developing. I'm working towards becoming a professional, just like many of the people on Twitch are working towards becoming professional artists. And I thought, for me, I really felt like I had something to say. And not that I had something unique to say, but that this was a platform that not a lot of writers are using. And in a lot of ways, I wanted to give back to the community. I wanted to push myself. I wanted to give myself, you know, on-screen deadlines and give myself an audience to hold me accountable to that. To learn by teaching, to learn by doing on screen. You know, like, improve, to become a better writer. And it's something that I'm going to discuss later, but recently I was reading this article by Isaac Asimov on creativity, and I'm going to come back to that because I think it's an important part of this episode. But Asimov talks about how creativity is kind of a embarrassing pastime. Or not pastime, but an embarrassing endeavor. How we don't be creative in public. And it, like, people look at you funny when you're creative in public, because, you know, you kind of have to be a little ridiculous, a little bit foolish. You got to challenge things, and that's not always an easy path to do socially. Right? And it's something that has come up in art streams a lot, where, you know, people are like, oh, how did you get this good? How long have you been drawing? Like, all these questions. And a lot of it is about, you know, practice, right? And people, like, artists are afraid of showing those 1,000 drawings they did that they sucked before getting to the one that was good. And
I was reading Asimov's article, and it really kind of struck me where he's right. In a lot of senses, you do have to be foolish. You have to ask ridiculous questions, and you have to do all these kind of things to be creative. But in a lot of ways, what this show allows me to do is it allows me to show the audience those elements, to show them that, like, it's okay to be ridiculous, it's okay to fail and all those things, and, you know, those are the, like, failure is one of the most important parts of learning. And as I say this, John Derek Murphy joins my chat, and he's one of the guys who talks about a lot of this stuff all the time, where, you know, artists don't want you to see what they were like when they were learning. They want you to see what they're like now, and I get that, but I think to teach people, you have to show them those things that they don't see, those hours that they don't see. And in a lot of ways, it's kind of interesting, because as a film person, as a person who studied film, there's never this idea of, like, they did a lot of Lord of the Rings, but they didn't do it in a lot of other films, where, you know, you don't see the heroes walking 10 days to get between the two towns that they go to, right? Like, that doesn't happen a lot, because it's not super interesting, but the end goal is. And in a lot of ways, that's what the practice is. It's like, oh, I'm going to draw 10 sucky lines, and it's not going to be fun. It's not going to be interesting, but it's that process, right? Like, I'm trying to show that process on this show. So, yeah. I'm going to totally suck. Like, my drafts go from, like, super bad grammatical sentences to much more polished. And I do a lot of iterations to fix a lot of those little small bits. And we're going to see that as we get into the show. On that note, the main thing that this show is about is starting a project and finishing it. So the first thing that we're going to be doing is that I'm going to start out with a short story. I want to work my way up by doing a short story and then maybe a comic book, and then a novella, and work my way up into longer and longer works and kind of see how far I can push this and how far I can demonstrate the process. And it's going to be really, really, really hard, but that's okay. That's kind of the point. So, yeah. And as Derek says, like, Twitch can be that change in perspective by showing the process. And I'm going to come back to that idea a little bit later when I start talking about creativity, because that's going to be the main part of this show, the second hour, which, as you can see behind me there on my awesome dry erase wall, that today's topic is going to be creativity. I'm gonna come back to that, and I'm gonna talk about things like failing and things like pushing those boundaries and all that stuff. I'm gonna take another approximately 20 minutes or so to kind of explain a little bit more of the little bits of the show. Some disclaimers and stuff, and then we're gonna take a quick break, and then get into the kind of the actual lesson portion of the show, which I'm super excited about and been talking about to people all day. And I think a lot of my friends are like, "Oh my god, like, who is this guy?" But it should be good. I'm excited. I'm really excited. So, the show's format is kind of gonna be three blocks. Three main blocks. It's a little bit different today, and it's probably going to be a little bit different next week, because these two episodes are kind of going to be my very my very big theoretical episodes, like big ideas, starting points, until we get into the more practical nitty-gritty stuff. The format's gonna be a little different, but in the regular show, how I'm planning on doing it in episode 3 or so, is there gonna be a first block, and the first block is gonna be about an hour, and it's gonna be the main sort of lesson of the day. It's gonna be, you know, what are we doing today? We're doing structure, we're doing character, things that I think that the project needs to be explained so that the project can be better. And also just things that, should be talked about at certain stages. So we're going to get to that. And then the second block is going to be like a very practical, like I'm going to have the writing software up. We're going to do a lot of writing. I'm going to talk about writing. I'm going to talk about my process as I write. I'm going to vocalize what I'm writing. All that stuff. You can ask questions, give me suggestions. So it's going to be a lot of that. And then the third block is going to be a little bit of like organizational stuff. Probably a lot of editing is going to happen in that third block. And there's going to be a Q&A, and there's going to be the Accidental Origin Book Club, which I'm going to talk about kind of at the end of the show today. And probably like almost every day I'm going to talk about, or every episode I'm going to talk about the Accidental Book Club. But we're totally going to get there. And I do see you, Jirani. I'm kind of on a roll, and I don't like stopping because then I get distracted. But the VODs will be up on YouTube, which is actually my next thing. And I haven't shown this yet, but I actually have like 5 pages of show notes for today. Like all detailed outlines of like stuff I want to talk about. So the next part is actually the website. So accidentalorigin.com, and I'm gonna link it in the chat. And it just went live about 2 hours ago, give or take. And so there is a YouTube channel. I'm gonna have all of the episodes up on YouTube. So people can watch them, and there's going to be an embedded video on the homepage of the website, and it's going to have all of the resources that I'm going to talk about throughout the show on it. So it's going to actually have a copy of the show notes, and it's going to have like videos I use for research, articles I read, the book club book, all that stuff. It's going to be up there so that people can see what I read. Like what influenced me, and you know, it's kind of like homework, like you'd see in a class, and in a lot of ways, I am kind of taking inspiration from what I've seen on what I've seen at university and all that stuff, and it is very much influenced by those things, and it's gonna be awesome. I am going for the gusto from day one, as it were. I kind of have an idea of what level I want this show to operate at, and I think I'm pretty much there. So hopefully it'll all just continue to work out. So yeah, so last thing on this section, which I'm going to talk about before I take a quick break. And so again, like I said, the first 2 episodes are going to be very theoretical. We're going to talk about very whimsical, like big ideas, and that's okay. And that's okay. Those are important things to talk about to lay a solid groundwork before we get into the actual like writing. The second thing I want to mention is channel art is coming. Sam J. Fraser, who's in the chat right now, he introduced me to an awesome graphic designer, and he's got almost all my stuff ready. But I didn't want to go live without getting the final everything together with that stuff. So there's not going to be anything too fancy today, and probably not next week, because I kind of want to keep these theoretical ones a little bit different to set them apart. But going on sort of episode 3, episode 4, we're going to see all that cool stuff, and it is amazing. I've shown Sam a few... I've shown my two Sams, who are in the chat right now. There's going to be three eventually, but the two that are in there right now, I've shown them the stuff, and we all agree, it's fucking fantastic. It's super awesome. So, yeah. Really excited about that. And third thing I just wanted to mention, especially because I am having a little bit of chat interaction at the moment, is that it's going to take me a few episodes to really get a good feel for the format. And really get a good feel for how what really works on the stream. Like I was talking about before, and this is something I had a conversation with Jonah Loeb about, another Twitch streamer, a while back, where, you know, writing is a very internal process. And a lot of it is time spent thinking and time spent not actually, like, doing stuff. There's a lot of aspects of just working through problems, kind of the same way that you see in programming and math and, like, all that stuff. And I think, as it happened, like, I'm pretty sure that I've got it kind of nailed down to my tests and stuff. But there's going to be a lot of that, like, getting used to it, getting to see what techniques work, and what's the best way to use my on-screen time to get the most across and work on the most things, I guess. Volume, as it were. So yeah, that's all awesome stuff. So yeah, don't be afraid to give me feedback. I do have an email for the web show on my website, as well as Twitch and Twitch messages, Twitter, Discord, leave comment in the YouTube channel. I'm gonna be looking at a lot of that stuff, looking for feedback. So don't be afraid to just post, you know. I do wanna reach as many people as I can, and I hope that everyone can take a little bit of something from this. So, yeah. We'll see how it goes. We'll see how it goes. Don't worry. My other camera, which you can actually see, like, right behind me there, that camera is not inverted. So, when we get to that portion, you'll be able to actually see the cool stuff. Don't you worry. It will be awesome. So yeah, thanks for all the comments about the website, guys. I have to admit that a lot of that stuff is just an awesome hosting provider who has sick ass templates. I didn't do a lot of it myself per se, but you know, I did play around with a few different formats, and the one I decided on I think is the best one for what I want to do. So yeah, I'm excited. Things are promising. Things are promising. We're off to a good start, though I did kind of expect this portion to take a little bit longer, but that was also kind of to be expected. So I'm just going to open it up real quick to the floor. If anyone has any questions they want to ask me, I know there's not a ton of you here, but if there's any questions you want to ask or something you missed that you want me to go over, just let me know. And yeah, I'll give you a couple minutes to think that out, and then we're gonna go take a quick 5-minute break or so I can stretch and do a few things, and then we'll get into the meaty part. Yeah, totally into a story about inverted mirrors and websites. Not last test stream, but my fourth test stream, because I did 5 of them. My fourth test stream, a couple of my friends actually started writing a fan fiction about DMX and 50 Cent and Space Marines in my chat, and it was pretty epic. So, Yeah. Totally. I'm totally cool with that. Go nuts. Go nuts. In fact, if people start doing that on a regular basis, I might save all those and put some things on my website about it. So, yeah. Yeah. All right. So, yeah. I don't see any questions right now. So, I'm going to take a quick 5-minute break or so. And then I'll be back. And we can have a big discussion about creativity. Which I actually spent almost a week researching. And I hope is going to be kind of enlightening. Cliff notes. A lot of people say the same things in a lot of different ways. But yeah. We'll see how it goes. We'll see how it goes. So, cool. Peace out. I'll see you in 5. Okay, I'm back. So, we're gonna go to this screen.
I'm still playing around with some stuff, and I might need to do some changes, so I don't know how well I'm going to be able to see chat from the wall, but we'll see how it goes. So yeah, today's topic is going to be creativity. And this lighting totally sucks, and I'm gonna work on it. I have like 6 lamps in here, like it's literally crazy. But yeah, so we're gonna talk about creativity, and we're gonna talk about the start of a writing project. So how do you, like, what do you need to start a story? Like, what necessary elements do you need? So I really bake it up to two things. The first thing you need is you need a seed. That seed can be an idea, but doesn't necessarily have to be a full idea. And I'm going to talk a little bit about the difference between those at the end of the, later on in the show. But the other main thing you need, other than a seed, is you need some sort of drive. You need some sort of motivating factor, and not necessarily just motivation, because as we've kind of discussed in a lot of the streams that we've had with you, Derek, and all that, motivation is not necessarily super consistent, and that sucks. So it's also, you know, the ability to work without motivation. And I label that as drive. So for me, the two things you need a seed and you need drive. So how do you get a seed? How do you get an idea? Where does that come from? And the answer to all of those questions is creativity. So what is creativity? What does creativity mean to you? So I looked up a bunch of different definitions, and there was a lot of cool ones, and I kind of just went with the Wikipedia one because it was simplistic. But the way that they defined it as a phenomena whereby something new and something valuable is formed. And that something doesn't have to be a physical object, though it can be, like a painting or a novel or an invention or a product, or it can be something intangible. An idea, a scientific theory, a musical composition, a joke, something, a philosophy, something intangible, something that isn't necessarily a physical thing. And those are things, when we talk about creativity, we talk about, you know, something novel. And I don't mean novel as in writing a novel, at least not in the current sense. But the word novel means new, something interesting. And that's actually where the novel was named and why the novel was named that. Because when it first came out, it was the new and interesting and popular thing. So yeah, that's where that's why we call them novels. And all that. So, you know, we're looking for something new, something novel. And we kind of ask, like, how do we be creative? How do we come up with those things? And throughout the research that I've done, there was kind of one TED Talk that really stood out to me, and also this really awesome article, which I spoke about a little bit earlier, by Isaac Asimov, which I absolutely loved. It was really complicated to read. There was a whole middle section that, like, I basically couldn't follow. Because it was like, if person has idea A, and the second person has idea B, and how do they join together to create C? But what if they have AC and AB, and like, it doesn't look blue? But that being said, the article itself and the overall parts of it were mind-blowingly awesome. So, there's two ways I'm going to talk about creativity, and they're both almost exactly the same. They use a lot of different terminology, and this is what I was talking about earlier, whereas creative types tend to say the same things, but they say them in different ways, not knowing that they're saying the same thing. And it's super interesting, because I watch Derek,
and I watched Jonah Loeb, and I watched Molten Ink, and a bunch of other people, and I've seen people, artists talk at conventions, and like all that kind of stuff, and they all say very much the same things. You know, it's all about color and drawing the eye and use of value and all those things. And those are awesome for art, but like, how do we apply that to writing, and how do we apply that to just being creative in general? So there's a very basic approach, and that's in sort of three steps. So I'm going to break out my whiteboard here, which is super sick and brand new, and I'm like super stoked about it. Erase this. So there's basically three steps. Number one, be curious. Be curious. Observe the world around you. See what people are saying. See what they're doing. You can learn so much by just watching what other people do. And that's especially true in art, and it's especially true in writing, I think, where, you know, Hollywood, especially has a whole thing where, it's a trend that we as scriptwriters or screenwriters have noticed, but like, Hollywood tends to release like 4 or 5 movies of the same type in a block. For example, when, Clash of the Titans came out, there was a bunch of other, like, sort of pseudo-Mortal God movies that came out all at the same time. And that's really how they... It's one of those things where, like, one studio starts a project, and another studio gets wind of it, and they kind of like, oh, we need to do something like that to compete, and then they kind of create all this thing, and then, like, they look at each other and all kind of make the same thing at the same time. And what ends up happening is you get this weird oversaturation, which then... like, forces the market to change simply by being oversaturated. And it's a super interesting phenomenon, but it's really annoying as a screenwriter, because it means you have to, like, predict trends in a lot of ways, and it's super hard. It's super hard. and weird. Like, just weirdly mind-bending. Mind-bending. Sorry. Be curious. The second part is work hard. Work hard. Creativity is very much a process. It's not something that just happens. You have to work at it. You have to work at it, and if you work at it, you'll get better at it. There's a lot of stuff, I'm gonna break it down a lot in smaller chunks later, but there's a lot of stuff about, you know, your brain is a muscle. When you do things a lot, it gets much better at what it does. You know, you do math problems, you'll get good at doing math problems. You do Sudokus, you'll get good at the logic of Sudokus, and your brain will just adapt and get better at those things. So there's a lot of hard work involved in being creative. Like, ideas don't just appear out of nowhere. And I know a lot of times we talk about the Eureka moment. And again, I'm going to touch on this a little bit later. But the Eureka moment is kind of a false positive, where it's actually something you've been thinking about for a long time, but it isn't until that moment that it all connects. So there's a process involved. And both Asimov and, God, I can't remember the name of the guy, but the guy whose TED Talk I was talking about, they both talked about it, where, you know, Darwin had this theory, and you know, he writes in his autobiography that he got it in this study in this one day in March, and it just kind of came to him, and suddenly it was all there. But if you look at his journals and you look at all this other stuff written about it, he had all of the elements of the theory for years, or, well, maybe not years, but he had it for a long time, and it wasn't until that moment where he read the right combination of things that kind of gave him the idea, that brought it all together for him. So, you know, work hard. It's a process. You'll get there. And the third kind of point is get lucky. And that seems like a super weird thing to say, especially because we're you know, I literally just said you got to work hard. It's not just luck. But in a lot of ways, it's also what we mean by get lucky is we mean expose yourself to a lot of things and opportunities will happen. Opportunities to talk to people. I mean, that's really what Twitch is doing for us right now, is offering us a platform to connect and exchange ideas. You know, I stumbled upon the Adobe stream because I was following Jonah and he just so happened to do it, and they just stumbled upon him and asked him to do it, and that led me to watching all these other people who are awesome, who are now actually in this chat, and we're having a discussion about it, and like all this stuff. And that's what I mean by getting lucky, is expose yourself and put yourself out there and exchange ideas and meet people and eventually something will click. Something will totally click and it'll be mind-blowing. Mind-blowing. So yeah, that's the main parts of being creative. And I'm going to take a step back from that for a sec, and I'm going to show you this. So my mom picked this up the other day to give to a friend of ours, and I had to use it for this show. Like I totally had to. It was perfect. So it's called the Boys Doodle Book, and this is super shiny, and my lighting is ridiculous. But when we flip this open, it's like this page here. It says, "Draw a dreadful dragon," and then this one says, "What did he do to get in trouble?" "What hatched from the dino eggs?" And I love this because it was like, this is exactly what I'm talking about. These are like the sort of things like, challenge yourself and try and experiment and work hard and all those things. And oh man, just thinking. Ugh. Yeah. Just quickly catching up with chat here. My PC is totally in that corner. So yeah. It's gonna be a little weird. I'm still playing around with this setup. But we'll see. And I keep like looking down and it's just like this giant light shining up at me and I'm just like, don't look into the light, don't look into the light. So yeah. So the next one I want to talk about is Isaac Asimov. And Isaac Asimov wrote this awesome article that wasn't published until a few years ago, when he was asked to consult on this Cold War defense project by a bunch of guys at MIT and like all this stuff, and he started working with them, and he eventually didn't do it because he didn't want to know classified information because it would silence his freedom of speech, which is so profoundly like being true to yourself in that way, where it's like, As a science fiction writer, like those technologies and all that stuff are totally things that would unconsciously influence his writing, and he didn't want to be censored in that way. And I wish I had that kind of integrity. I hope I will someday, but oh man, I respect the hell out of that. But yeah. So Isaac Asimov, and his only contribution to this research study was this article, essay if you will, about being a creative. And the basic premise that he talks about in being a creative is, uh, be a fool. And especially, don't be afraid to be a fool. And the reason he says this, which, you know, you kind of have to get in deep for all this stuff. But what he talks about is that being creative is an embarrassing thing. People don't like you being creative. And because of that, it's very much a individualistic thing. It's very much an individualistic thing, but that doesn't really work because you need to expose yourself to all these ideas and work towards something much bigger than yourself. And to do that, you have to talk to people and all those other things, same as I was saying earlier. And in a lot of ways, what he's talking about is you know, we're gonna go be individuals and we're gonna be foolish and we're gonna ask all these ridiculous questions and we're gonna push the limits and break the boundaries and all that stuff. And people are gonna look at us funny. They're totally gonna look at us funny. But then we're gonna take all these foolish ideas and we're gonna bring them to a bunch of other fools and we're gonna sit down and we're gonna have a conversation. And the conversation is going to be pretty short because you don't want to be in a room too much together before someone gets embarrassing. And you don't want to be in a room where there's a definitive, like, personality that's gonna automatically take over the group because that's going to be more stifling. And you don't want a guy who's not going to be foolish with you because, again, that's going to – as soon as someone says something – then suddenly the entire group's not gonna want to be foolish anymore, and you're never gonna get anywhere, and all this stuff. And he's talking about the exact same things that I was saying before, where, you know, he's saying, you know, be curious, ask questions, ask dumb questions, just ask questions, because the answers that you get may not be as dumb as you think. Like, you'd be really surprised how much you can push with that stuff. And, you know, work hard, you know, put yourself out there, get lucky, get in those meetings, talk to people. Maybe they'll tell you the fact that you need to put it all together like Darwin. So yeah, like, I totally recommend you read the article. It's on the website right now. If you look in the episode one section, fascinating read. I hope I explained it. I hope I gave it justice to how he did it. But yeah, so there's all that. And then the most important lesson that I want you to take away from this, and it's something I said a little bit earlier, but I'm gonna say it again, is that failure is the first step of learning. You don't learn nearly as much from success as you do from failure. That's true. That's a proven fact. I've seen it in 1,000 different things from 1,000 different people from 1,000 different disciplines, and it is a fact. That's not to say you can't learn anything from success. There are just less takeaways. So, to talk about that, I'm gonna give you several examples. And these are the popular examples, they're the ones that a lot of people talk about. But the most famous example being Thomas Edison. Thomas Edison is famously stated as quoting that he created 10,000 light bulbs before one worked. 10,000 light bulbs. And that might not seem like a lot to us, because, you know, I'm sitting in a room and there's probably 7 light bulbs pointing at me right this second, plus the ones on my screens, plus whatever. But if you never had a light bulb ever, and you had to make one from scratch, how would you do it? Would you try 10,000 times? Could you try 10,000 times? Like, that persistence and that like working on a problem, that's what I'm talking about. Because everyone would call you a fool for trying 10,000 times to do something like that until you change the world. And, you know, the second example I'm going to talk about is a little bit more commercial and a little bit less sciencey in that way. But the guy who invented the Dyson vacuum, John Dyson, I believe his name is. I think it's John Dyson. He created 5,000 prototypes for his vacuum. 5,000. And let me just say that 5,000 vacuums is way more complicated than 5,000 light bulbs. There's a lot more machinery there. There's a lot more different things, and man, like, that's a lot of persistence. So, takeaways. Failure is the first step of learning. You learn more from failure than you do from success. Try, be curious, work hard, get lucky. Am I dropping frames? Oh, I was dropping mad frames there, guys. Sorry. Hopefully it's cleared up. I seem to be doing okay again. We good? Maybe? I don't know. I'm not getting any feedback. I'm just going to keep going. So the last little bit of advice I have before I dropped about 6.8% briefly. It seems to be going down though. Okay, cool. I think this is you, Derek. You're on your own, buddy. Sorry. The last bit of advice before I talk about where we get ideas is literally write everything down. This is not super specific. Like, a lot of the stuff I said so far is very general and applies to not only writing, not only art, but also science and business and all those things. But this one's pretty specific towards writing. And if I can think of a really cool application for an art, I'll let you know. But literally write everything down. There is nothing unusable out of any bit of writing that you ever write. In most cases, it's just not usable in the current thing you're doing. My friend, Sam, and I'm sorry I'm telling this story, Sam, but I'm going to tell it. My friend, Sam, on one of my test streams a while back, he was showing me the opening line of one of his stories. And the opening line was, Asimov was wrong. Talking about robotics. And that line, or no, I'm sorry, not Asimov was wrong. Oh, just talking about Asimov too much. Turing was wrong in regards to the Turing test. My mistake. And it was such a fantastic opening line. And I was just like, oh my God, like, this line is so unbelievably good. And I'm sorry if you don't think that right now in the chat, but I love that line. And it didn't fit with what he was trying to do. And I told him, and he's the one who gave me the advice to include this point in my talk. But he was like, I told him, keep that line, keep it separate, keep it somewhere, because there'll be something later that will be the perfect thing for. And that's what we do as writers. Keep everything, keep every scrap, keep every idea, write it all down, keep it in audio recording, keep a video of it, like whatever, keep it. Flip through those files every now and again. Especially when you're stuck on something, I can guarantee you that you'll find something that will jog your memory or create some sort of new synapse connection that will force you to get over whatever hump you were having. I've seen it done. I've done it myself. It totally happens. And all of those things, like those little bits and those little scraps and those newspaper articles and those images and all that stuff, will come in handy at some point. It will. And yeah, so keep that in mind. Just do it. Keep everything. Trust me.
All right, so just check on chat really quick. All right.
I'm glad you guys are all conversing with each other without me. That's kind of a lot of what I was trying to do with this, is I really just want to stimulate a conversation. Because that's how we learn, right? By talking, by networking, and all that stuff. So on that note, where do ideas come from? Where do we get ideas? There's a kind of a funny story with this, I wrote down a bunch of like three main places that I get ideas, and I was reading a bunch of articles, and they had five, but three of those five were the same things that I was saying, and then the other two were in the Asimov article and all that stuff, and that's what I was saying earlier, where all these people are saying the same things. They really are. I mean, I was saying the same thing without any help, like just out of the top of my head, and I'm nowhere near as good as these people. Like, I would not compare myself to Asimov, ever. Not in a million years. Yeah, man. It's crazy. But I'm actually going to switch back to the computer for this section. So bear with me a quick sec.
Gonna go back. Whoop, to this screen. There we go. Thanks, guys. I appreciate that. I hope it helps. And the reason, part of the reason why I wanted to do kind of the two episode, that's true. The two episodes that lay the groundwork was, I kind of wanted to give a little bit back to the guys that inspired me, who do art and not just write, you know. And I think that the first couple of things episodes are really going to be about artistic endeavors in general, not just writing. Mostly because they're very, very, very similar in a lot of strange ways, in ways that you wouldn't think. I'm reminded a little bit of an episode that Jonah Loeb did, and I'm probably going to talk about him and Derek a lot because I watched them a ton when I can, but he was doing an episode on how to give your drawings character, and everything that he said, and maybe this is partially because he's a writer, but I think after watching a few Moltening streams and all that stuff too, and he said some similar stuff, I think it's just about characters, but everything he said was just as applicable to writing as it was to art. where you know, you talk about what happens when we see a character. If he's slouching, what do we think? If he has a smirk, what do we think? If his eyes are piercing, what do we think? And yeah, writing is not necessarily visual in the same ways, but how we describe a character using those same ideas just gives us the same nuances, because we interpret characters the same way whether or not it's in writing or a drawing. It's just in drawing it has a more immediate impact. But it's still perfectly applicable. So in a lot of ways, I think the way that I'm going to talk about writing, especially because I studied comics and I studied film, that I'm going to talk about writing in a very visual sense, because that's what I studied and that's what I think I'm good at, more so than anything else, that a lot of the things that I say are going to be applicable to art and all those things. So yeah. There's five areas that ideas come from. The first one is associating. Drawing connections between two unrelated things. I'm gonna open up. I prepared for this, guys. Trust me. I prepared for this. I have a bunch of photos and stuff that I'm going to show you, which is why I switched back to the computer. I just got to find it. Where did I put them? Here we go. Yeah, perfect. All right, so we're good. Connecting two unrelated ideas. And I really wish I had more credits for some of this stuff than I do, but yeah, I was silly way back when, and I saved a bunch of stuff that I've actually had sitting on my computer for years upon years, and I don't have credits for any of it because I got it from weird places, and it's really too bad because I would love to give out credit to the original artists and stuff of this stuff, but I think it's applicable either way, and I'm going to go with it, and if the artist sees this and wants to send me a message, please do. I would love to hear from you, because some of this stuff is awesome. But yeah, associating. And this is one of my favorite parts of where ideas come from, and I think it's one of the things that I'm personally good at. And that's something you'll come to know about me, is that I think we all kind of know what we're good at and what we're bad at. And I'm not afraid to say that I think I'm good at something. Whether or not I'm right, who knows, but you know, like that's just the type of person I am, and I think part of that confidence, allows me to get over my insecurities as a writer, which any artist has. Also, it helps me to kind of do this to have enough whatever to do this kind of show, right? So hopefully it won't be too off-putting or jarring. But making connections between two unrelated things, and this is a big idea that a lot of the research I've done has talked about. You know, making those connections. How do you get from A plus B to equals C? And a lot of what we talk about when we talk about people who are genius. Not saying I'm a genius, though. Maybe I am. Just saying. A lot of what we talk about when we talk about geniuses are people who make those connections, who are able to think outside the box, is the way that we often describe it. And you know, like it's not about intelligence or anything like that. It's just about being able to think in a different way and put together those connections. So I'm going to show a couple images just to give some examples. So we're going to go to my main screen, and that's really tiny. I'm going to blow this up a bit. So this is a series of images that I got from somewhere. The credit says Dorkly. I have no idea where I got them because it wasn't from Dorkly. But it's a series of Pokemon Pokemon-style creatures who are based off of other video games.
And I'm just going to flip through these pretty quick, but, you know, you got Krashikoot. And you got Laura Croft here. making jokes about the original and the reboot of Laura Croft. Samus. Different types of Samus. There. Solid Snake, who's literally a snake. Assassin's Creed. The two eagles. Desmond and Ezio. Ezio. Is it not Ezio? Whatever. Assassin's Creed. Super Mario. Sonic and his billion iterations. Link. That's all of them. That's all the ones I got. But also things like... what else we got here? How about Super Mario done in a traditional Japanese art style? Right? Or, how about, well, I think that's all I got right now. But you start to see what I'm saying, right? Like how do you connect these ideas? These are unrelated things. Oh, here's the greatest one. I just found it. So this is one of my favorite images ever. The Colbert Puff Report. So connecting ideas, connecting unrelated ideas, seeing what happens. And that's going to come back in number five, but, you know, don't be afraid to connect things that no one's connected and try things. You never know what you might get. So yeah, that's number one. Number two is questioning. Question everything around you. And this one is actually my favorite, is my 100% favorite of the five, because, and I prepared for this, guys, what if is the most important question an artist can ask, in my opinion, anyway, the most important question. And the thing I want to say about this, and as you can see here by the crazy background, this is all the What If Marvel comic series, and I'm going to talk about that a little bit more in detail as we get through this. someone let Chippers know that it will be uploaded on YouTube, and the links are in the bottom. If he looks cool, thanks guys. I'm probably gonna have to play with my settings because it was performing better last time and I've switched some things up, so we'll see how it goes. Again, this is an ongoing experiment for all of us. So yeah, but yeah, most important question, get back to that. Most important question, what if? And I wish I had gone through with it, but the magazine never really got off the ground. But one of my friends who runs an independent role-playing game company, their company had a periodical, and I was writing this article about what ifs for him, and so I wrote this like 1,500 word article, which I don't have anymore, unfortunately. About the question, what if? And I, man, like
this question just everything I do is about this question. And we see this all over the place. I look at my bookshelf and I see Osamu Tezuka and Oda Kirihito and MW, you know, big what if questions. I see Naomi Novak, His Majesty's Dragon. Where, you know, like, what if Napoleon had dragons? How would the Napoleonic Wars have changed? Harry Turtledove writes a ton of stuff like that. I think Larry Niven does too, if I'm not mistaken. Maybe I'm confusing him with someone else. I read this awesome sort of... I read this awesome one about a bunch of Roman generals, like historical Roman generals, fighting aliens. Which I can't remember who wrote that, and I'm really sorry. I wish I could. The what if question drives so much of how we remain creative. Yeah, thanks, Sam. How Free Remain by Turtle Dove. Exactly. Like, these what if questions, and a lot of those examples I've used are historical questions. But, you know, like, it applies in so many ways. One of my favorite writers, and you may not consider him a writer, but I do, one of my favorite writers is Guillermo del Toro, the filmmaker, who writes most of his movies that he directs. He produces a lot of movies, but he also, most of the ones that he directs, he writes. Almost all of them, in fact. I think there might be one that he didn't, and I might actually be wrong and there's none. But Guillermo del Toro, like, Pacific Rim is a what if movie. It's this like intense study of mech shows that he's totally like done all this stuff with, and researched and asked the what if questions. What if it was like this? What if it was like that? Why isn't it like this? Why isn't it like that? And you know, that's how we came together with the dual link thing and all that stuff. And man, I rewatched Pacific Rim a couple weeks ago, and so good, just solid on those details and the way that he paces them and all that stuff. And you'll probably hear me gush about a lot of people like that. I'm a big fan of filmmakers who are very detail oriented, and how they tell and how they show you those details on screen really matters. I'm definitely going to talk about that stuff a lot. Another good example, I'll come back to it. I mean, I have all these covers of what if right here, right? So let's click on one. What if Wolverine was Lord of the Vampires? And Marvel, in their infinite wisdom, Marvel, and DC kind of did this too, and I'll come back to that. J.K. Rowling, though my Nightbot was supposed to ban you for that, but you know, whatever, we'll talk about that later. Marvel, in their infinite wisdom, wrote several different volumes of What If, in which each issue explores a what if scenario that changes the Marvel universe. Or changes a single character enough to affect the overall universe. What else we got? I actually read this one and I loved it. What if Captain America had been elected president? It was a great issue. It was awesome. This is amazing. What if the Amazing Spider-Man had not married Mary Jane? Well, you get the events that happened when Doc Ock took over his body and caused the universe to revert itself, and he stopped marrying Mary Jane again. Because, oh my god. that continuity. And we'll talk about that a lot, too. But yeah. So Marvel did this, and they're all... Not all of them are good, and some of them are really dumb, and whatever else. But they asked this, and I respect the hell out of them so much for just publishing these. For the hell of it, just to explore. What DC did was DC actually published a line of comics. And I'll pull it open here in another window so you can't see ridiculous things. They published what we called what they called Elseworlds. And in a lot of ways, Elseworlds were... here we go. Elseworlds. They were kind of like an exploration of the different versions of heroes. But in a lot of ways, the ones that they picked were really cool what-if questions. So I want to see if I can find it here real quick. I don't see it. There's a good one. Red Sun was an Elseworld. If anyone knows Red Sun, this one here, where basically Superman is a communist and is Russian and is a communist, and it's ridiculous. The one that I'm thinking of, here we go, Thrill Killer, by the excellent Howard Chaykin, who wrote a bunch of ridiculous things, including several porn comics and a bunch of other stuff. Thrill Killer, I believe it was Thrill Killer, yeah, where Batman is actually a woman, and Robin is her lover, and the Joker is actually Batman's mother, who turned into the Joker, and like a bunch of stuff. Like, it gets really weird. But yeah, like they asked the what if questions. I mean, what if isn't the only question, but it's the important one. But yeah, question yourself, question your surroundings, question why people do things. Like a lot of the times, what we see is that people kind of like, oh, we do it because that's the way we've always done it, and it's when you kind of can think of, can work towards another way to do it that's better. That's when you're being creative. You're a creative person. You're innovating. So yeah, the what ifs. The third part, and this is very much tied in, of observing. Scrutinize the world around you. Look at things. Explore things. See things. There's this really cool place, and I'm gonna. It's going to be really weird because most people don't know where I'm talking about. But at the Rideau Center in Ottawa, where I live, there's like this little spot beside the bus station on the bridge, on this bridge. And there's a little corner, and it's like a balcony. It's like five feet wide, 5 feet by 5 feet. And it's tucked away in the end of the mall where the bus station is. And it overlooks this one single giant tree and this like little log cabin. And I have no idea what's in the log cabin. I should really find out one of these days. But it's like this little cul-de-sac. And every time I go to that little balcony, there's no one ever there. There's a few people walking by going to the bus station and all that stuff. But it's always empty. And I just go there and I sit and I look out and I wonder, you know, why is that there? Why was this dumb like this? How would I write about this place that's here? And I'm always just struck by that, like, little paradisical thing in the middle of this urban mall and, like, no one's ever there, and like it's all that stuff, right? Like observe, see things, watch people, study people, all that stuff. So that's number three. Number four, and I'm actually doing really well for time on this one. Number four, networking. Go out and meet people. Listen to people's ideas. See, like, go to other countries, go to other places. I know not everyone can go to other countries all the time, but, like, go to other cities. Go to places you don't usually go. Talk to people. Find out what makes them tick, what their opinion is on things. Those inspirations are often what cause you to be you, to take what makes you awesome and put it out there in new ways. I'm reminded of this this really cool documentary, a show about street vendors, like food trucks and stuff. And there was this awesome guy in the middle of nowhere in England, and he makes this ridiculous Thai dessert, and he makes a show out of it. Like, he has a whole he's like, if there's nobody around, I just take out an onion and start dicing it, and it's just, he went to a place and he ate this food and he loved it and he mastered it, and he came back and he's like, how can I give this to the people? How can I show these people these other viewpoints, this other perspective, these new things? And that's what networking is. And that's what Asimov talked about when he was saying, you know, be foolish with other people, but only do it for a brief period of time, because, you know, it's mostly a solo thing and all that other stuff. And also with the get lucky and the work hard and all those other things that I've talked about today. Those are all aspects of that. And then the fifth way you get ideas is by experimenting. Try things, knowing that they'll fail, just to see what happens. You know, I have the example of the what ifs and all that stuff. Like, they weren't going to be good stories. Not all of them. Some of them are really shit, to be honest. But, you know, you try it just to see what happens. What comes out of that? How can I push that? Try writing prompts. Try writing experiments. And I'm gonna give some of those later on when we talk about creativity as a muscle and all that stuff. But try those things. Do things. Don't be afraid of doing things. It's okay to look foolish. It's okay to fail. You're gonna learn something. And that's what's important. In one of the TED Talks that's on the website there, there's this awesome, he talks about how he wanted to find out how people react when you have a snake or a turtle on the road. And so he went out and he did this experiment for 10 hours in the baking heat, where he had a rubber snake and a rubber turtle on the road, and he measured these things, and he wore a lab coat so it would look serious and all that stuff. And he told his friends, and they're like, you went outside and stood by a road and watched cars go by for 10 hours. He's like, yeah, I did. And it was awesome. I learned something. And that stuff is what I wish I could do, which I wish I had the time to just sit and try writing experiments all the time and try and push myself. And I'm hopefully going to be able to do some of that stuff on stream with you guys. I really hope so. Maybe even next episode, now that I think about it. Maybe. We'll see. I'll get back to you on that one. But I'm hoping so. So yeah, those are the five the five main ways that people get ideas. The one thing I will add, so the five ways: associating, questioning, observing, networking, experimenting. The only one I'm going to add to that, and this is probably integrated in a lot of other things, is that the other way for a writer to gain ideas is to go out and read. Read things. You're not going to get good just by writing. Yes, spend the most of your time writing, but also read. Read the type of things you like to read, read the types of things you don't read, and you don't think you're going to like. You'd be very surprised. And I'm gonna admit this live on stream, and eventually when this all blows up, which I hope it does, but who knows, when this all blows up, people are just going to be like, what the? But I actually really like Nora Roberts. I think she's really good at what she does. She's not like mind-blowingly good or like any of that stuff, but she has a very cool formula that she's very good at with, and she's very good at making it adapt different situations and scenarios. And she writes her characters very well and very consistent. So, you know, I actually like Nora Roberts. I wouldn't say I love Nora Roberts, but I like Nora Roberts, and I'm not afraid to read a Nora Roberts book to this day. That being said, Daniel Steele nearly gave me an anxiety attack. I got halfway through the first chapter and nearly died. So that's a whole other ballgame. But the point is that you'd be surprised what you think is good, even to yourself. You got to expose yourself to that stuff. You know? You never know. Never know. Oh, God. Am I dropping frames again? Sorry, gang. So, yeah. Takeaways. I like Nora Roberts. I'm weird. It's fine. You'd be surprised. So, I have a couple of things about mistakes or misconceptions people have about ideas and creativity, which I will go over. And then, after that, we're going to talk a little bit about exercises. And then I'm going to talk about ideas as they relate to writing specifically, very briefly, because that's going to be mostly content for the next episode, but I am going to go over it a little bit in brief. And then we're going to take a break. So I'm aiming for about 24 minutes so I can take a break at 9 o'clock, but we'll see how it goes. Misconceptions. There is no such thing as a single eureka moment. Creativity is not something you're born with. Well, technically it is, but it's weird. We'll talk about it. Creativity is a muscle. I think that's all I got. But those are the three things we're going to talk about right now. So the first thing, there's no such thing as a single eureka moment. And I've said this a few times throughout the stream, but creativity is a process. Oftentimes there's this conception that, you know, somebody woke up one day, like Darwin woke up and he sat down in his office and suddenly the theory of evolution was just there. Just unfolded in front of him. But that's not how it happened. And we know that's not how that happened. We can prove that's not how that happened. Even if his autobiography says that's how that happened. Oftentimes an idea takes a long time to stew. Like, there's little connections flying around inside you. And you just gotta keep chewing on that problem until something clicks. And not all of that is conscious. And I don't want to say that you can consciously do this all the time. But your subconscious is going to be working on those things. It's going to keep working through. I read an article in a writing magazine once that talked about the difference between introverted writers and extroverted writers. And I totally didn't read the part about extroverted writers, though I really should have. And maybe I will. I'll make it a point of one of my things to talk about some of the writing magazines that I have, because I have a ton of them for whatever reason. Mostly because I just buy magazines sometimes. But the introverted writer, which is what I consider myself to be, they talk about things like taking breaks. Go and do something different so that your subconscious can keep chewing on the problem until it gets out there. And as a writer like that, I think doing something like this Twitch show is going to be awesome, because I wasn't planning on really doing any outside writing off screen. We'll see how it goes and timelines and things. But having the ability to kind of like say, well, I'm working on this on the show, and then take a break and have it all just process while I'm working, like while I'm doing other things, is awesome. It totally appeals to me, where I can chew through that stuff, waiting for my eureka moment where it just clicks and I can go back into it the next episode. You know what I mean? So yeah, creative is a process. It's not a single eureka moment. It's a constant thing. You have to work at it. You just have to work at it. So that brings me to the second point. What was my second point? Jeez, forgot my second point. Oh yeah, right. Second point. My second point was, creativity is not something that you're just born with. And it's kind of weird, because I'm going to immediately disagree with myself and say creativity is totally something you're born with. But the misconception isn't in that fact. It's that everyone is born with it. Or wait, I said that wrong. The misconception is that they think only certain people are born with it. In fact, actually everyone is born with it. And there's been a lot of interesting talk about this lately, and it's something that I've been particularly interested in because of my personal experience. Is it dropping real bad, guys? I'm thinking of upgrading my internet soon. So I'm hoping that might fix some problems, but it seems to be going down, so I'll just give it a couple seconds. Okay. Yeah, right, so what I was saying. Yeah, so there's been a lot of interesting things, TED Talks and a lot of other stuff about it, where we talk about the idea that the current education system, actually takes our creativity away from us, because we're naturally creative as kids. And Johnny asked the question earlier in chat, where she said, why do kids get all the cool shit, all the cool books? It's because they're naturally creative. They want to play pretend. They want to make things up. They tell stories that make no sense. They do things because you know, the lava on the floor and all that other stuff. Like, kids are naturally imaginative and naturally creative. And we kind of lose that as we get older. And the really the great thinkers, the people that we like to talk about, and the people that I kind of aspire to be, aspire to, like my heroes and all that, are the people who are kid-like. They're okay with being foolish, seeming foolish to adults, because they're being kid-like, they're being curious, they're exploring possibilities. So, yeah, like, creativity is something that we all have. It's something that you can work at to be better at. It's not just that somebody has a...
And I'm going to expand on this point, actually, now that I think about it.
That talent exists. Talent is a thing. But talent is also something that you can get. Right? We talk about people... Mozart. We talk about Mozart. Mozart's a genius. He's a prodigy. Mozart studied music for 14 years before he wrote a piece. 14 years. Let me just let that sink in. 14 years. No one talks about those 14 years. Ever. Or very rarely, anyway. But... yeah, he had talent. But he worked to foster that talent. You're going to have natural affinities. You can get good at something by practice. That's proven. These people don't just like appear. I mean, they do in stories. And I read manga, so there's tons of them where they just appear fully formed with all this talent that they never knew they had. But people aren't like that. That's not how people work. You can't be good at something you've never done. You might be better at it because you've done similar things. Like a person who's good at soccer might do pretty good at football just because they're in shape and they have a sports mindset. But that doesn't mean that like automatically they're going to be the best running back ever. Like it's different. It's different like that. Just like, you know, people who are good at art and good at certain types of art aren't necessarily going to be good at others. You know, someone who's good at drawing might not be the best painter or the best sculptor. There's parts of that. But because they can think about art in a certain way, that means that if they pick up the physical skills and develop that already existing talent, they can become a really good sculptor. And all that other stuff. And I'm telling you, all you out there, right now, that you can become a good writer. I 100% believe in all of you. Because I started writing when I was 12. And I worked at it. I worked to get to where I am today. And I'm not even a professional or anything like that. But... there are lots of people who came to the game way later on in life and got good. I don't like his work, but the example that comes to mind is Jeffrey Archer. Jeffrey Archer is a super popular writer. I don't think much of him. I don't know. He doesn't write things I'm that interested in reading. Which, you know, it happens. It's okay to like and dislike people. We have differences of opinions. But... he didn't start writing until he was like 35 or 40 or something. Like, it doesn't matter when you start. It just matters that you work at it so you can get good. Enough said. That's all I'm saying about it for now. So last part, and I'm going to try and cover this. And I actually might come back to the exercises after the break. But creativity is a muscle. And this kind of builds back into the previous point, is that the more you do a certain type of thing, the better you're going to be at it. Your brain is going to make connections. And the really good example of this is actually hybrid disk drives. And I don't know if any of you really know how hybrid disk drives work. But basically the idea is that there's a physical drive and a solid state, and they're together. And what it does is it identifies the programs that you use all the time, and it puts those in the solid state, and then puts the rest to the hard drive, the ones that you don't access very often. So what it's basically doing is it's saying, oh, you do this a lot, so we're going to make it easier for you to do this. And your brain works exactly the same way. Your brain says, oh, I've been doing math for 3 weeks, so we're just going to do more math, and it's going to be fine, because we made those connections already. And creativity works exactly the same way. Just like writing works the exact same way, and all that. You know, art works the exact same way. The more you do it, the better you're going to be at it. Because your brain's going to make connections. And it's going to enable you to be better at it. Obviously, there's practice and there's certain things you need to do actively to make yourself better. But your brain is not going to make that harder for you. It's just not. So, do things. Do things a lot. So, yeah, just do things. Do things, do them all the time. Live them, breathe them. You'll be much happier, trust me. Because I'm an expert. And the one thing, the last point I'm going to make about that is kind of an interesting and hot topic. The idea of writer's block, or artist block, or blocks, whatever. And I can't speak about art as well as I can about writing, because I'm not an artist in that way, or a visual artist. Is that writer's block, to me, it doesn't really exist. What it is it's a lack of planning. It's a lack of creativity. It's a lack of motivation. It's a lot of little factors that build up into this thing. And the best way to get around it is to just take a step back, take a break, work on something else, allow your subconscious to process all those things, come back to it with fresh eyes, and then put some words on the page. Because any words are better than no words, and you can always come back later and fix them. And yeah, as Sam points out, that's probably a little antagonistic. And I might say a lot of things like, oh, well, great, Brendan, you have tons of ideas. Good for you. I'm not like that. But I spend a lot of time in my day, like, asking myself what-if questions and asking myself, you know, like, oh, I hear these kids talking on the bus about this party they went to. Like, what happened at that party? Who was there? Like, why were they throwing it? Was there an event? Was it just a thing because it was the weekend? You know, what happened? What stories are they telling? You know, who was there? Who caused what drama? That's a story. That's storytelling. That's what we're going to be doing. So, on that note, I need a break because I've been talking for like over an hour, almost an hour and a half. So I'm going to take a quick 5-minute break again, and hopefully let some of that sink in. And don't be afraid to ask any questions. I am watching the chat and all that, so please do. Hopefully you guys are learning something from this mess of thought spew that I have going on. But yeah, so we're going to come back. And we're going to do exercises, and I'm going to talk about ideas, because I started off this segment about talking about, you know, what do you need to make a to write a story. And I'm going to finish off this segment after the break, obviously, with my final thought on that and how this all kind of relates back through that whole mess. So, yeah, 5-minute break. I'll see you guys in a bit.
All right, I have no idea how long it's been, but I'm coming back. I'm back. Cool. Exercises. Right. So I'm just going to round out my theory talk for tonight. Then we'll do a little bit of practical stuff and then start closing out the show. And we'll say we'll do practical stuff for about 30 minutes and then we'll close out the show with a few things. So, if you remember, and I barely remember, so I don't know how you remember, but if you remember about an hour, 2 hours ago-ish, probably around 7:30, you heard me talking about what do you need to make a story. So, I said two things. I said you need a seed and you need motivation. Or not motivation, you need drive. Which is not the same thing as motivation, as I said. So, seeds. And this is something I'm going to expand on next week, but I am going to say it a little bit in detail right now. And this goes back to a lot of the things I've been saying over the course of the show, there's this concept that I have coined in my head as ideal length. And this should be something, I haven't done enough research into this, but again, this is going to be a topic for next week in more detail. What we call ideal length, what we're going to call ideal length. And ideal length is something that I've been talking about a lot recently when it comes to writing. And has to do with the idea of seeds and all that stuff, where ideas have suitabilities. They are good for certain things. And this is something I've seen a lot as studying screenwriting and all that. There are some really good novel ideas, and there are some really good screenwriting, like film ideas. And there are some really good television ideas, and they all work a little bit differently. All right? And you can do some transfer back and forth between certain things, but there are some things that only work as one medium or one thing. And this has a lot to do with Asimov and all that stuff, because he was a very prolific short story writer as well as novelist and all that other stuff. He basically just wrote everything all the time. The construction of a short story is different from the construction of a novel. They have a lot of similar parts, but the idea of a short story it's because it's so condensed, there are a lot different ways that you have to approach it. And ideal length comes directly into that. Ideal length is what I used to refer to an idea that's really good for a short story because it's this big. Or an idea that's really good for a novel because it's this big. Or an idea that's really good for a film because it's this big-ish, but it really works visually. It works in this visual sense. Or this idea is really good for a comic because having the panels in this way really would make it give it real good oomph, impact. Ideal length. And then seeds are a part of that. Because a seed, what we call a seed, is not necessarily a whole idea. And the way that I'm using the word idea here, and I'll probably talk about this a lot over the course of the shows, language is very unclear, especially English, and that we mean a lot of things when we say things, and some of them are true and some of them are not, don't get me started, and this is exactly what's Sam's saying in the chat is it's also important to keep in mind that certain media allows for different levels of story specificity. No, I don't know. You get what I'm saying.
Yeah. So a seed is a part of an idea. It's what an idea comes out of. A seed, or sorry, I totally missed a step here. Ideas, I was defining ideas. So when I talk about the word idea, an idea for a story, what I mean is a premise. Or a log line. Which aren't exactly the same thing, but do very similar things. Have very similar purposes in different medias. A log line generally is used for film, more so than anything else, but you can also use them for other things. And we'll talk about that more in detail later. But it's a big enough form with an idea of a plot and a character and a general problem. That's an idea, to me, as far as writing goes. So yeah, you have kind of enough stuff there to start working, like to start on the writing stage. A seed can be a part of that. It can be a single character, but you don't know what he's doing or why he's doing it. Or you can have a location, or you can have an inciting incident, but you don't know who the character is or why this is happening, but you know what the specific incident is going to be. And it seems weird for me to say that, because you're like, well, how can you tell a story like that? And you can build around those things. It takes a lot more work, but it's certainly doable. And in a lot of ways, the way that writers come up with ideas, or at least that me and my friends come up with ideas, are building on those sort of blocks of, you know, having a seed and then expanding it and then adding things to it and adding more seeds. And eventually you're going to have a whole fruit orchard, and that fruit orchard is going to be your story, and it's going to be awesome. So, yeah. So I just wanted to bring that all sort of full circle and say that, you know, when you're being creative as a writer, you don't have to have all the answers right away. Your entire story is not going to jump from your mouth fully formed. There's going to be a long process of working on it. And sometimes you're going to be waiting a long time for things to click and your story is just all there. But getting that seed and having the drive to continue with that seed, to keep watering it and tending it and weeding it and all that stuff so that it can grow, that's the important part, and that's the takeaway that I want you guys to take from this episode. So, cool. And if any of you want to write along with me, please do. I encourage it. I can't guarantee that I'll be able to look at all your stuff or any of that stuff. We'll see how that goes. I'll come up with I'm still working on a process for maybe doing some of that stuff. But we'll see how it goes. So spend this week, like, thinking about a seed. What's your seed going to be? And even if you're not going to write it, you don't have to write it, just come up with a seed. And we can do some exchange stuff next time and see kind of what people have come up with. And so, in order to help that, yeah, that's the end of theory for today. Cut. So we're gonna do a couple of exercises that me and Sam talked about a few days ago. Excuse me. Just to kind of get you generating stuff. And I'm going to show you a website as well, because I love this place just for random doodles and fiddling around. So, going to go back to the whiteboard. I'll detail out some exercises, and I'll show you a website. Cool? All right. Well, back to the wall. The wall. Man, I love this wall. It's going to be so epic. Cool. Excellent. So, we're going to have two exercises. Just
things to think about,
ways to generate.
And unfortunately, I can't do them on screen because I don't really have the copyright access or a few other things here. But maybe I'll do them in the off during the week sometime and bring back the results, and we can talk about it. But the first exercise is something I did in my drama writing class and something Sam also talked about doing with me a while back. And it's the overheard conversation. Am I writing? No, we're good. Overheard conversation. Yeah. Cool. So, in order to do this, basically what happens is in your day-to-day, and I know this happens to all of you, in your day-to-day, you're gonna hear people talking around you. So what I want you to do, and I'll try to do this as well, is there are two ways that it's been suggested that you can do this. The first way, number one, I'm hoping this is legible, I'm still working on the lighting. Number one is you copy down a few lines that someone says, and you write a scene. So, basically the way this would work, like say I was sitting on the bus, which I was today, and someone said something about their boyfriend cheating on them. So I'd write that down. It's like, oh, I'm sorry I couldn't go to your house because I found out my boyfriend was cheating on me. And then I write a scene based on that conversation. So you take one or two lines, some interesting, something weird, something odd, and you write it down, you write a scene. Then you can use that scene to write a second scene, and then a third scene. And suddenly you've got a story. Right? So, that's one way. The other way, and this is the way Sam suggested, but it's kind of the same idea, is that you take five random sentences that people say during the day, over the course of your day, and then make a scene out of them. Again, doing something very similar. So, two ways. Pick one. Do whatever you want. But essentially, this is doing almost exactly the same thing, where you know you're taking five bits of conversation and you're constructing a story, a very basic story, but a story nonetheless. And this is one of the reasons why it's kind of important to do this is you kind of learn a little bit about basic blocks of what makes story interesting. And dialogue is a very important part of that. So that's one exercise. And then the second one, is what I call the music mashup. Yeah, we can see that. Cool. Music mashup. So, again, in a similar thing, there we go, that's better. Too much shadow. The way this works is you take five random songs and then it really helps if they're from a wide variety of genres and styles. But you take five random songs, and then you either use the lyrics, or, because not all songs are good, like, have great lyricists and lines are usable like that, or you use the overall feeling of a song, to write five short scenes. Which then, again, you have sort of the construction of a story. And that's really what I'm trying to get you guys to do. Is start constructing little seeds that you can use to build something bigger. Like maybe what you do from this exercise isn't really usable within itself, but there's a couple lines that you can save for later that will make an excellent story. So yeah, thinking through all that. And then, lastly, before I talk about the last couple things and sort of close things out, we're going to go back to this main screen here. And I'm going to bring up a website. Boom. Seventh Sanctum. The home of every generator you could ever want. And I often come to this place just to hang out, see what I come up with, see what's up. There's so many things, and they're always producing more and all this stuff. But you'd be really surprised what you can use computers to jog your cogs, as it were. So I'm gonna go down. They actually have a bunch of like writing prompts and a what ifinator, which I love so much. If I haven't gushed enough about what ifs as it is, here's some great ones. What if Carl Jung fought Saint Francis? Fantastic. Oh man. What if William Blake was a mobster? So good. But yeah, these are all really awesome seeds for a story. And in my screenwriting class, we did something very similar. Where what we did was we took five actors we really liked. It didn't matter who they were. Five actors we really liked. And then five locations, five genres, and five problems. And what you do is you put them all together, and so you end up with things like what was my one? God, I can't even remember now. But it's like Park Shin-hae in an office. And the problem is the office moves, and like it's a sci-fi, it's a thriller, it's a romance. Like you can do these weird association things where you're trying to jog your creativity and see what you can come up with that would actually be really interesting to write. So yeah, totally do it up. If anyone's coming back, which I hope a lot of you are, we'll see how it goes. We'll do a sharing time where people can share any of that stuff they've done during the week. I'll make a point of it. I'm writing it down for next week.
Cool. So yeah, I'm gonna end it a little bit earlier this week than I plan to normally. I've been talking for a long time today, and just not really a lot of practical stuff. It's still a little bit away yet, but I'm planning for the main show to be about 3 hours, 3 1-hour blocks. That wasn't really the case today. That's fine. I do have a few more things to talk about before I go, but I will end a little bit early. But the last thing that I want to talk about is actually more of an administrative thing. Well, sort of. So what I want to talk about right now is I want to talk about the Accidental Book Club. And we're going to go back to the big phase here. So the Accidental Book Club is something that I'm going to be doing over the course of the show. And what it is if you see my bookshelves, I own a ton of books. I own a lot of books about writing. I own a lot of books about art. I own a lot of books about being creative. I own tons of stuff like that. I own magazines. The problem is there's a lot of them that I really haven't read. Like, some of them I've read a couple chapters, some of them not even that. Like, there's a lot of that stuff that I have that I haven't read. So what I want to do over the show is in the hopes of pushing myself, is I want to read those. And I want to share what I'm reading and why I'm reading it and what important takeaways I get from it over the show. So every episode, there's going to be approximately 15-minute segment at the end of the show where I talk about what book we're reading over the course of 2 weeks. I'm going to do it bi-weekly every second episode. There's going to be that section in... not clear at all. So that segment is going to be in every episode, but I'm only going to read a new book every second episode. So the first of the two is going to be an introduction to the book, and then the second of the two is going to be my conclusions after reading the book. Just to give me enough time to actually read them. I read pretty fast, but I don't have a ton of time to do everything all the time, so I just want to make sure I actually have time to read the books, because I do want to read them, and I do want to share with you what I'm learning from them, because I think it's important. I think it's important. So yeah, and I'll be a little bit more clear about that schedule as we move forward. But yeah, so this week, and I have it here beside me. This week we're doing Brick. And this thing already failed me. There we go. We're reading Brick by Brick: Principles for Achieving Artistic Mastery by Stephen McGrane. And this is actually one of the books that I've read the most of out of my library. I love it. Stephen McCraney, his comic, like it's an artist's perspective on being an artist, and it's all written in comic essays. And there's one comic essay called "Be Friends with Failure" that I absolutely love, and it just, like, I had a printout of it on my desk for so long, for like years, and it's just super inspiring about, you know, you're learning to do to be an artist, you're learning to draw, you're learning to write, and you actually can't expect yourself to be Isaac Asimov overnight, to be Van Gogh, to be Da Vinci. You don't, and he uses this analogy where he talks about, you don't insult a baby because they can't talk yet when they're learning to talk. But in a lot of ways, we're at the baby stage of our art. So we can't hold ourselves to the same standards as those people. We aim for those standards, yes. You want to push yourself so you can get to those standards. And I'm not saying that means it's okay to make bad art. I just mean that you got to realize that you're learning and that you're not going to be that great right away. So don't give up. Don't give up. Make friends with failure. Learn from failure. Because if I haven't said it enough, failure is the first step of learning. 100%. So, yeah. Anyway, this book is filled with cool stuff about procrastination, about art, about depression, about, just so many things that are important to being a visual artist in his case, but also a writer and all that other stuff. So, if that hasn't convinced you, hopefully my conclusion next week will, but there's a link on the website, which I will link again. It's also in the bottom of my profile. Go check it out. There's a link to his store and his website where he's working on a new book about branding, which is actually super interesting in a totally different way. But yeah, check that out. I will continue reading it. But yeah, I think Stephen McCranny is awesome. There's a big bundle pack that comes with posters and stuff. So I got the Be Friends with Failure, which sat on my desk for so long as a little printout. I actually have the full-size poster of it, and I'm going to be hanging it up in my office soon, hopefully. I'm still working on getting a frame for it. But yeah, it's going to be like directly across from me there so I can see it every day. And I'm super excited about it because it's just such an inspirational book. But yeah, so that's pretty much all that I've got for today. So just in summary, failure is the first step of learning. You too can be creative. Anyone can be creative. It's not something you just automatic. It's something you can work at and get good at, and just like any other art, any other skill. And yeah, don't be afraid to be a fool. Takeaways. Yeah, cool. So that's the end of the first episode. I will keep the stream running for about 10-15 minutes. If anyone has any questions they need to ask me, I'll be in chat, I'll be interacting. So yeah, if you didn't catch the beginning of the show and you want to ask me a few questions about what I covered and stuff, just let me know, and I'll go over a few things. But yeah, about 10 minutes or so. So yeah, DD Don, bot commands. Right now, the ones I have are set to regular, regulars and above. I will see what's going on with that. I haven't decided 100% what I'm doing with it. But I will hit the thing for you, if that helps. Oh. Come on. Do it up. There we go. Boom. There we go. It works. Still playing around with it. We'll see. See, did I miss anything in chat? Just flipping up here. and I see that he's still in chat, but he hasn't, oh no, he's gone. But I did want to quickly thank John Derek Murphy for the host, and for all my friends from his stream who came and hung out, and all that good stuff. So, yeah, I think this is about it for me. So, yeah, show's done. Hope you all had a good time. I will be uploading the VODs and all that tomorrow. As well as rewatching it and finishing the show notes and posting those as well. So hopefully that'll all go smoothly. We'll see how it goes. Anyway, Oh, the book club. No, it isn't that kind of book club. It's more of I just want to read the ton of books about writing and writers that I have, and this is kind of a public forum for me to force myself to do that. Because that you know, that helps, you know, with like deadlines and having accountability and all that. I can probably come up with some if we decide as a community that that's what we want to do. Totally. But I mostly just wanted to share, you know, things that I'm reading and why I'm reading them and why I think they're good or bad or whatever. So just to give a general overview of some of the stuff in there, the next book, maybe I should write some formal reviews. That'd be pretty cool. We'll see. I'm still on the fence about some of that stuff. It's mostly just because I don't have a ton of time, which is why this is really only going to be a weekly show. Ooh, I probably should have said that at the beginning. It's only going to be a weekly show. That's fair enough. I am not the type of author who really wants reviews. I like a little bit of layers of distinction between that, which is weird because I'm doing this Twitch show, which I'm directly interacting with people. But yeah, no, that's a good point. And I will definitely write that down and think about it. Maybe not a full review, maybe more like a 200 word blurb or something, but we'll see. We'll see how it goes. and I totally agree with you about supporting, which is part of what I'm like, why I'm doing it on stream, and not just like on a side thing, because like I've been changed by this book, and I want to share that with other people who are creative, and hopefully that will help them and help support the writer and all that stuff. But yeah, as I was saying, a couple of the other things that I'm going to be doing with the book club. The next book I'm going to be doing is going to be Sid Field's book screenplay, The Foundations of Screenwriting. Because it's kind of like the be-all, the end-all of screenwriting books, and everyone recommends it. And I bought it for class, and I only read part of it. But he talks about John Renoir, and I'm a huge John Renoir fan. The director. Guy's unbelievable with depth of field and lighting. Like, oh my god. Yeah, so the next one I'm going to be Sid Field. I'm also going to be doing... I think I'm going to spend a month or 6 weeks or something on, maybe a month. We'll see. Yeah, I study screenwriting. That's what I study. I study screenwriting in college. It's actually called script writing, and it was more than just screenwriting. I actually studied, playwriting as well. But film, television and plays, and a little bit also of like things like PSAs and doing internet videos and all that kind of stuff, which was pretty cool, but it's just a totally different thing. And I also am heavily invested in comic books and will be doing comic book writing at some point during the stream, which I'm very excited for. I'll probably be the second project I do after the short story. But yeah, I'm super excited. So what I was saying, I'm going to do probably a month to 6 weeks on Scott McCloud's Understanding Comics series, which is super good. And I'm going to do 6 weeks probably on Will Eisner's books on writing comics, which are totally different for a whole bunch of different reasons. I am an attempted novelist. I've tried it. I'm not that great at it. It takes a lot of dedication to write that long of a thing. That being said, I'm trying to be better about finishing projects in general, not just starting things. So that's one of the things I'm trying to work on with this stream. But yeah, visual storytelling, which is how I describe comics and film, is extremely different from novel writing. because you got to communicate different things, and it's so different. But it's different in a good way, and in a lot of ways, the way that, and I'm thinking next week I'm going to show some examples of this, but of my failed novel, which is a big step for me because it's a little personal, but we'll see how it goes. But there's a lot of things I took from visual storytelling that I brought to writing a novel. So there's a lot of things like sound effects and pacing and things that I do a little bit differently because they come from that sort of visual sound background. But yeah, we'll see how it goes. There's a lot of similarities. There's a lot of differences. There's takeaways. So yeah. Anyway. Yeah. What else I got? Just because I'm curious, Judy Dawn, were you the person I followed earlier? Were you streaming earlier today? Because I followed the only other writing stream that was on. just to see what was up. And once you answer that question, then I'm going to go. Oh, and actually, because you asked there, I don't do art, but a bunch of the people who were in earlier are artists, so maybe I can convince them to do something for me. We'll see how it goes. But yeah, that's all stuff in the future. I mean, you write scripts to write scripts. You don't write in to do all the stuff, but we'll see. Okay, cool. Well, I will give you a follow on my other account, my actual watching account, and check you out. See what you do. See if maybe I can learn some things from you and use them for my stream. Real reviews, yes, that thing. Cool. So yeah, everyone who's here, all like seven of you, thanks for being here. I appreciate you. I will see you next week. So yeah, don't be afraid to be a fool. Failure is the first step of learning. Bye, guys.